Driving. I'm Easy Rider, and welcome to Toku Time, where a country boy can survive. Yeah, I wanted to do this one outside for a change. You'll find out why soon enough. But it's tribute time again on this show, and this time I want to pay tribute to one of my greatest inspirations on this show. He's a historian, a comedian, and an American hero. One of the greatest horror movie hosts who ever lived. A man who could make any movie just more fun by watching with you. I am, of course, talking about the king of the drive-in, the legendary, the one, the only, Joe Bob Briggs. Born in Dallas, Texas, and raised in my home state of Arkansas, John Bloom got his start writing movie reviews in the newspaper in college. But in the 70s, when he started to review exploitation movies, he took on the persona of Joe Bob Briggs, a redneck who isn't afraid to speak his mind about whoever or whatever is bugging him. Politics, religion, gays, minorities, no one is safe from his ridicule.
Well, I've been going around ripping cheesecake off the walls here, and you know why? Because there's a federal law about it. This judge in Florida says that you can't hang up pictures of the Miss February Iron Horse Biker Bikini Girl anymore over your desk. They were tacking them up on the lockers at the Jacksonville shipyards, and this lady welder got her feelings hurt because nobody had ever asked her to be the Miller Lite Hooter Honey for the greater St. Petersburg area or whatever, so she decided her workplace was full of sexual harassment. And she won the case! The feminists helped her file her lawsuit, and she won! All the naked women have to be ripped down off the wall now. They got their wish. They finally made it an actual crime to think about sex with a strange woman, or to even talk about it in the presence of a woman, or even to be thinking about it. I don't think America is ready for this.
Guys like Joe Bob are a dying breed nowadays. Seriously, if people acted more like him, the world would be a better place. Joe Bob was also a horror movie expert and lover of the three B's: blood, breasts, and beasts. In 1982, his Joe Bob at the Drive-In review column was featured in the Dallas Times-Herald. And with that, Joe Bob's rise to stardom had begun. The column was generally popular and soon became a syndicated article in many newspapers around the globe. Joe Bob was very outspoken about his love for the drive-in and drive-in movies, especially when New York City began to close down many of the grindhouse theaters on 42nd Street. He was quoted as saying, "This is the one place in New York City where you could see a decent drive-in movie." Joe Bob to this day still fights to keep the few drive-in theaters that are still around alive. He likes to call everything else like megaplexes and mall theaters and big budget films indoor bullshit. This is what he would call indoor bullshit. This is indoor bullshit right here. In 1985, Joe Bob printed a parody of We Are the World, which at the time was a popular collaboration song about famine in Africa. Calling his version We Are the Weird, Joe Bob listed off his opinions on the famine in Africa and various other risque topics at the time. Unfortunately, this created a major backlash, leading to the cancellation of his syndicated column and the loss of his job. Well, look on the bright side, Joe Bob. At least you had the guts to do that. Nowadays, people can't go 5 seconds without someone calling them Hitler for disagreeing with them on the slightest little thing about their opinion. You got balls, man. After the We Are the Weird incident, Joe Bob made the transition to comedy. For a time, he became quite popular with his own one-man show, during which he performed several of the monologues and rants that he would become synonymous for later on. A year or so afterward, he was asked to guest host the Movie Channel's Drive-In Theater, a show featuring cheesy B-movies, softcore porn, and everything in between. He was soon chosen to become the permanent host, and Drive-In Theater became a smash hit that lasted over 9 years.
Yeah! The snack bar is open!
The one, the only, the original Evil Dead. Most of you turkeys know by now that I have been waiting 9 years for this night. I wrote letters. I screamed at the jerkolas who had the rights to this movie. I tried to get it for the first annual World Drive-In Movie Festival and Custom Car Rally back in 1982. I called up all the meatpacking plants in Fort Worth thinking they might want to sponsor a screening during Red Meat Week on the movie channel. And I fought with the movie channel high sheriffs for 4 solid years, and all they ever told me was it's too grisly for cable. Nobody has any respect for the arts in this country anymore. So you're thinking, well, hey, what's the big deal? Just another zombie splatter movie, right? Well, no, there's one difference. There's only one way to kill the zombies. We're talking total dismemberment. Hands, arms, legs, and of course, heads will roll. You thought those were zombies in Night of the Living Dead? Excuse me while I go buy you a copy of Richard Simmons Sings the Frank Stallone Songbook, Wimp City. You think those were zombies in Dawn of the Dead? Wait here just a minute while I go check the showtimes of Flashdance for you. You might want to look around for some leg warmers to wear on your ankles and a t-shirt with Snoopy on the front. Now that Grandma has left the room, let's take a look at the old Evil Dead barf meter. This is the Paint the Room Red Vomit Champion of the 1980s, and as you can see, it's off the scale. You might want to go get a few hefty bags while there's still time. In other words, it's a classic. It follows the Joe Bob Briggs ultimate test of a splatter flick. Anybody can die at any moment. It was the first movie of Sam Raimi, the guy who made Dark Man, but this was back when nobody'd ever heard of Sam Raimi. We just thought he was a psychopath from Michigan. He checked out some film equipment from Michigan State, got some actors from the university, found an abandoned house in Tennessee, and he did all the amazing special effects in the attic of his house by himself. What a guy. I don't want to tell you anything about the plot, but here at Drive-In Theater, we call it Spam in a Cabin. The teenagers go in, the teenagers do not come out. But it's the way they die that matters. Once you've seen this, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre could be shown on the Disney Channel. Roll the flick.
And you thought internet reviewers did it first. Nope. It's safe to say that Joe Bob Briggs was reviewing crappy movies before all of us here in the reviewerverse were even in grade school. Before he introduced the movies, Joe Bob would always open with a rant about what's wrong with the world today, or something wrong in his personal life, or rather his character's life.
They even have these laws about exactly how you're supposed to throw away your phone books. Isn't this getting a little specific in the legal statute department? How often do you throw away a phone book? Once a year, right? Anyhow, they really do come and write you a $45 ticket if you don't do this, because it's so important that if we don't do it, the rainforest will die or something, and all the landfills are full of disposable diapers, so this will help us get rid of some of the stink. And they have these factories that can take Dr. Pepper cans and beer bottles and turn them into patio furniture. I don't know what they do with this stuff.
After that, Joe Bob would always give some trivia about the movie or movies they were showing that night. And at the end of the night, Joe Bob would always talk about the drive-in theaters, ones that were reopening, ones that were staying open, and ones that sadly had to be closed.
I have a communist alert, I'm sad to report. The Atco Twin Drive-In in Atco, New Jersey has been turned into a New Jersey Transit bus terminal. Dan Taylor of Haddonfield, New Jersey reminds us that without eternal vigilance, it can happen in your town. You know what's really disgusting about that is that New Jersey is where the drive-in was invented in 1932.
He also answered viewer mail brought to him by the smoking hot mail girl, Honey. No, seriously, that's her name.
One of the most beautiful women in the known universe, on the other hand, is our own movie channel mail girl. And here she is again, looking even more gorgeous than usual.
That's it?
No, there's more, as a matter of fact. You're not only the most beautiful woman on television, you're the hardest working, the most intelligent, and you have a certain savoir fricassee about you.
What is that?
Savoir fricassee. It's like, it means you're beautiful even in France.
He even took requests from fans about which kind of movies they should show on future episodes of Drive-In Theater. That, and he would always close with a joke or two.
Stick a fork in me, I'm done. Did you hear about Bill Clinton going to this baseball game with his wife? And a Secret Service man leaned over to the president and whispered something to him, and suddenly Clinton nods and he raises up and throws Hillary out of the box. And the Secret Service man says, "No, you're supposed to throw out the first pitch." Joe Bob Briggs reminding you that the drive-in will never die. Do you guys know what 10,000 battered wives have in common? They just won't listen. What did the blonde do when she heard that 90% of all accidents occur in the home? She moved.
For all you young people who don't know what the hell I'm talking about, think of it as an 80s version of the vlog. Only better lit and has a budget and doesn't tend to drag on for like an hour.
Have I ever told you about my favorite nightclub? My favorite nightclub in all of America is this place called Live Girls Totally Nude No Cover Buffet Lunch Truck Drivers Welcome, which is located just outside San Bernardino in the Ontario, California airport, and it stays open till 4 a.m. even on Thursdays. The reason I'm bringing up Live Girls Totally Nude No Cover Buffet Lunch Truck Drivers Welcome tonight is that I don't know if you've noticed this in the paper, but the Supreme Court just made the dang place illegal.
Well, the 90s rolled around and the movie channel decided to change up its image. Sadly, drive-in theater was not part of that image and was canceled, so Joe Bob had to find a new place to be the horror guru that he was.
Hey! I heard that!
Horror guru? Oh, come on, that joke was too good to pass up. Come on.
Well, in that case, I'll just let it slide. This time...
Luckily, TNT's Monster Vision needed a full-time host, and Joe Bob Briggs was the man for the job.
Hey, I'm Joe Bob Briggs, and I'm here to tell you that if you're not watching Monster Vision Friday nights on TNT, then frankly, I'm embarrassed for you.
Hop into a night of killer rabbits when Joe Bob brings you Night of the Leapers, next on TNT.
This is where myself and a lot of my friends saw him for the first time. Around this time, I was still in high school, and Mystery Science Theater 3000 was my craze, but I found Joe Bob Briggs just a little bit more informative as opposed to being just funny. Yes, 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 before you start bombarding my email with a billion requests, fear not, I will get to that show in a future tribute episode, so cool it. Monster Vision was already a great show, but when Joe Bob came on, it was 10 times better. But it had its share of problems. Namely, the TNT censors basically cutting out or trimming down all the things Joe Bob loved about these horror movies. The boobs, the swearing, the real bloody stuff. He spoke out against this censoring time and time again, most notably during his trademark gimmick, the drive-in totals. This is where he listed all the nudity, body parts, deaths, sex scenes, fights, you name it, he counted it. And he would always add the suffix food, anything and everything.
Right now, the Tall Man is about to enter your living room in Phantasm 2, the sequel it took Don Coscarelli 9 years to make. It has 3 flying silver balls instead of the 1 in the original flick, and a severed hand instead of a levitating severed finger. But otherwise, it's the same deal. The Tall Man is taking corpses down to his mortuary and turning them into killer midget monks again. So let's take a look at those drive-in totals and get started. We've got 12 dead bodies. Exploding house, 1 4-barreled sawed-off shotgun, dwarf tossing, 10 breasts, of course those are scissored out of the TNT version, embalming needles plunged through various parts of various bodies, 1 motor vehicle chase with crash and burn, ear lopping, forehead drilling, wrist hacking, bimbo flinging, grandma bashing, devil sex, crematorium foo, flamethrower foo, and this movie contains the most terrifying scene I've ever witnessed, a perfectly decent 1971 Hemi Cuda flipping over, landing on its roof, and bursting into flame. I cried for 2 hours. It's amazing what they let these people do for the sake of a goddang movie. A Hemi Cuda, greatest muscle car ever made. So many horses in that baby you couldn't get insurance for it. They use it for a stupid movie stunt. It's like cutting up the Mona Lisa, you know?
A tradition I like to carry on today in my Henshin Roundup on Writer Ramblings. Yeah, sure, call me a copycat if you want to, I don't care. I prefer to think of it as an homage to Joe Bob's greatness. So sue me. Joe Bob even brought Honey with him for a while, but she was soon replaced by 2 different male girls for the duration of Monster Vision. Joe Bob still read letters and even hate mail on the air, which he almost always laughed off.
I'm Joe Bob Briggs, and people do write to me, and some of them try real hard to get on TV. Let me tell you something that won't work. Hey, Joe Bob, you remind me of a castrated pigeon. Please read this on TV and say my name and the name of my cousin and tell me when it'll be on. Okay, here's something that will work.
Dear Joe Bob, not since the novels of Leo Tolstoy has there been a genius able to speak to the whole world as you have since the arrival of Monster Vision. Now, you see the difference? Castrated pigeon, Tolstoy. Don't forget this. Send those letters and cards to me in care of Monster Vision, 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318, or email me at monstervision@turner.com. Maybe Tolstoy's a little far. William Butler Yeats, better example.
Yep, even in the 90s, you weren't safe from being trolled. Speaking of the internet, Joe Bob was very verbal about his feelings about the internet. And keep in mind, this is when the internet was brand new, and we had no preconceived notions about how disturbing it would become later on. But I like to think Joe Bob knew.
People say to me, Joe Bob, where can I download? I don't want to hear about that. Ask your mother about that. But if you want to find out about the Monster Vision schedule or read some of the weirdest mail I've gotten since my ex-wife sent me a cherry bomb Valentine or just ogle the Playmate of the Week, then write this down, tnt.turner.com/monstervision. 24 hours a day, you can waste time there and download all you want.
Well, a new decade came along. It was a new millennium, and TNT wanted to be known for its drama. Oh, God. And you guessed it, Monster Vision was canceled. Joe Bob did stay on for a couple more months, though, doing what he did best. And as the internet and a massive supply of DVDs soon rose to become the permanent new medium, it seemed that Joe Bob Briggs and other horror movie hosts were going the way of the Betamax. Yeah, sure, why watch some guy on TV tell you about all this neat trivia about a movie when you can just Google it now? Well, to this day, Joe Bob is still finding ways to carry on his passion for drive-in movies and horror rarities, in the form of DVD commentaries and writing articles. Stint on The Daily Show doing God stuff.
The good news is Pastor Murray has a very talented defense team. I'm John Bloom, and this has been God stuff.
We're so excited about the birth of Jesus, joy to the world.
And eventually, Joe Bob finally jumped on the internet bandwagon and has his own website now, joebobbriggs.com, where he still reviews any and all movies he can find. Drive-in totals included. In a world where technology now reigns supreme, Joe Bob is still doing what he loves to do and keeping the spirit of the drive-in alive. There may never be another drive-in theater or Monster Vision, but Joe Bob pushes on, continuing to spread the word of horror movies and the three B's, and I find that kind of admirable. Joe Bob Briggs was a huge influence on my life, and I've said it before and I'll say it again. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be doing this show today. He talks about and reviews what he loves and spreads his passion for drive-in movies around the world. And I like to think I'm doing the same, only with crazy TV shows and movies from Japan, but hey, beggars can't be choosers. I salute you, Joe Bob Briggs, and to show my respect for you and the drive-in, I'm going to take the drive-in oath right now. I suggest you folks at home do the same.
I don't know if this is a drive-in crowd or not. So I tell you what, to find out, I'm going to swear in this crowd. I want you to all rise for the drive-in oath. Raise your right hand and repeat after me. We are drive-in mutants.
We are drive-in mutants.
We are not like other people.
We are not like other people.
We are sick.
We are sick.
We are disgusting.
We are disgusting.
We believe in blood.
We believe in blood.
In breasts.
In breasts.
And in beasts.
And in beasts.
If life had a vomit meter.
If life had a vomit meter.
We'd be off the scale.
We'd be off the scale.
As long as one drive-in remains.
As long as one drive-in remains.
On the planet Earth.
On the planet Earth.
We will party like jungle animals.
We will party like jungle animals.
We will boogie till we puke.
We will boogie till we puke.
The drive-in will never die.
The drive-in will never die.
Amen.
Amen.
All right.
Play ball. Well, that's it for this episode. Until the next Toku time, I'm Easy Rider, reminding you that the drive-in, much like the fan sub, will never die. Later.
You know, a lot of people write me and say, "Hey, Joe Bob Briggs, just what is monster vision? You don't need no special glasses or an insect's head. Just a healthy love for slime and disrespect for the dead. We'll talk about some movies by the old double wide. And when you get that creepy feeling creeping up inside, well, then you got monster vision. It's a heck of a fright. We're tearing the heart out of Saturday night. These monster vision movies serve a primitive drive. 'Cause watching people die can make you feel so alive. So throw away your clicker now, the flicks of a gun. 'Cause there's nothing you can do while fully dressed and such fun as watching TNT beneath the bug zapper light. We're tearing the heart out of Saturday night.
Tearing the heart out of Saturday night.
Tearing the heart out of Saturday night.
I'm sure I'll get bombarded now by all the geeks who run the Friday the 13th websites. I say that with the utmost affection and respect. I love you guys, but I'm sure I screwed up there somewhere. Okay, time for part six. This is the movie that asks the question, why should we even try to kill him anymore? You know, Jason's always had the ability to levitate himself all over Crystal Lake, jumping out of refrigerators if he has to, in constant search of teen veal. And in this one, nothing can kill him. Not a thing. Metal gate post through his head. No problem for Jason. 8 pistol shots, 3 shotgun blasts, boulder dropped on his brain, drowning. Nope, don't work. I've come up with the only real way to kill Jason. You know what? What is it, 5 in the morning? What would happen if you did the one thing that Jason couldn't stand? The one thing that would be just as deadly to Jason as kryptonite is to Superman? What if Paramount Pictures refused to renegotiate Jason's contract? Would that make him mad or what? I can see him now trying to bust through backlot security to enforce his sequel clause, to resurrect his video cassette rights. Now we're talking movie.